Next up on our list of requested films to cover is Departures, the internationally acclaimed drama-comedy about a failed cellist turned mortician. This one was requested by YouTube user Alexander Fogus. Thanks for the suggestion, Alexander. We're glad we could finally get around to talking about this one.
For those of our viewers in the US, the film is available on DVD through E1 Entertainment, and on DVD and Blu-ray in the UK through Arrow Films. We definitely recommend you check this one out. It's easily available, and we have a strong feeling you won't be disappointed. Either way, the film mostly speaks for itself, so we won't be getting into spoiler territory much today. Let's get the ball rolling, though, and jump right on in.
Departures follows the story of Daigo, a young, newly married cellist whose orchestra goes bust within the first 15 minutes of the narrative. Having played the instrument since he was a young boy, Daigo saw this as his big break and spent 18 million yen on the cello we see him playing. This means that, without the orchestra gig nor a day job, he can't afford to pay off the instrument and has to sell it. Luckily, Daigo's recently passed mother left him a house up north, where he and his wife Micah moved to start fresh in the country.
Once there, Daigo begins his job search anew, accidentally applying for a position as a mortician. In the newspaper ad, instead of The Departed, a misprint caused the print to read Departures, a mistake from which the title is derived. Having expected to be a travel agent or something of the sort, Daigo is initially reluctant to work with Departures, or The Departed. But once he sees the pay, he can't pass up the position. We'd also like to note that even though everyone turned in notable performances for the film, probably our favorite has to be from Daigo's boss, who is played by Tsutomu Yamazaki. You might recognize Yamazaki from his earlier roles in several of Akira Kurosawa's films, as well as Juzo Itami's Tampopo. Yamazaki's reverential, understated performance in Departures puts on full display the skills he honed over nearly 5 decades of acting experience.
The remainder of the film explores the emotional impact this job has on Daigo, as well as his changing views on death and how we, the living, treat the recent departures. Oh, God, dang it! It also explains how Daigo's new occupation affects Micah, and how others view the couple. It becomes a heartfelt, dramatic, hopeful, and comedic exploration of the relationship between the living, the dead, and those who connect the two. The director stated in an interview that he wanted both comedy and gravity within the film, but that neither should occupy too much of the runtime so as to tip the scales. Rather, the comedy is of an empathetic sort, just as the drama is. We feel for the characters, and we relate to them, laughing with them rather than at them, both in good times and bad.
In this way, it's easy to see why the film swept numerous Japanese prizes, like those at the Japanese Academy Awards, the Yokohama Film Festival, the Asian Film Awards, the Blue Ribbon, and Kinema Junpo. What's more, this is technically the only Japanese film to ever win the award for Best Foreign Film at the American Academy Awards. Oh, did we not mention that part?
We say technically because back in 1951, 54, and 55, Rashomon, Gate of Hell, and Samurai, The Legend of Musashi won the honorary award, a catch-all precursor to the category of Best Foreign Language Film, which was added in 1956. After this formal category was introduced, while a number of Japanese films were nominated over the decades, not a single one took home the prize until the 81st Academy Awards, held in February 2009, when Departures finally provided the country with its first official win.
This being the first win for Japan might seem strange when you consider the pedigree of Departures director Yojiro Takita. A number of classic masterclass directors whose names resonate even with a Western audience received nominations. Kon Ichikawa, Keisuke Kinoshita, Hiroshi Teshigahara, Masaki Kobayashi, Akira Kurosawa, twice no less in Kurosawa's case. Yet the first winner was Takita, who began his career in the genre of pink film.
Not that this is a slight against the man. A number of other directors we have covered in the past, and even more who are known as the modern masterclass, got their start in the pink genre, or had some brush with it in the course of their career. Pink film in the 70s through the 90s was somewhat analogous to the assistant director system of old, or the genre of V cinema of the 80s and 90s, It provided a lot of contemporary directors their first jobs in the industry with a relatively high amount of freedom. Over time, as the record shows, many moved away from the genre and gained international acclaim for their non-pink efforts, while others have never completely left those roots behind.
In this manner, Yojiro Takita is something of a prototypical director for the pink to professional career path. He worked in the pink industry in the 1970s and 1980s, before moving on to direct for TV and comedy films in the late 80s. Takita continued in this manner until the late 90s, before transitioning once again in the 2000s into dramatic film. So while we know him internationally for his masterful combination of comedy, drama, quirk, and heart with Departures, the skill required to meld these different elements likely comes from his storied past. And while Takita might be responsible for putting the project together as a whole, the beginnings of the project sprung from another source entirely.
The screenplay for Departures was written by Kundo Koyama. Being primarily a fiction writer who has released many novels, this was Koyama's first script, although it was based on a short story from his 2006 collection Film. He made some changes in adapting his earlier story, namely the inclusion of Daigo's skills with the cello. He stated in an interview that he listens to music when writing, which usually affects his stories. During the adaptation of Departures, he listened heavily to the works of Yo-Yo Ma, which inspired this change. Perhaps the biggest change, however, came at the behest of Masahiro Motoki, who plays Daigo.
Motoki, a popular member of the boy band Shibuga Kitai during the 1980s, entered the film world in 1989 after the band broke up. During the 90s, he seems to have left his past behind, immersing himself in film entirely. Prior to Departures, perhaps his biggest role was in Takashi Miike's The Bird People in China. Around this time, Motoki also traveled to India and underwent a spiritual experience. Additionally, he learned about the trade of Nokan, the type of mortician practices seen in the film, and the Nokanchi, practitioners of Nokan.
Taking this newfound knowledge, Masahiro Motoki wanted to make a film revolving around death and the practices of Nokanchi. However, in the 1990s, this was not exactly a popular topic. Even in 2008, prior to the film's release, no distributors wanted anything to do with the film. It wasn't until after it took home so many awards, both at home and internationally, that the film found success with a popular theatrical run.
Nokan as a practice, and as Departures shows, involves the ceremonial beautification and dressing of the deceased, prior to their cremation. Initially, the practice was carried out by the communities in which the departed had lived, but by the 1960s, Nokan became a proper profession. While practices undertaken by Nokanshi can be greatly varied, Motoki himself trained with professionals prior to the production of Departures, and Takita has stated that he gave Motoki free rein to essentially direct these scenes of the film himself. Thus, while differences could certainly be observed between individual Nokanshi across Japan, we can have faith that the ceremonies on display in Departures are realistic.
Similar to Antarctica and how it impacted the popularity of the Sakhalin Husky for two decades after its box office success, Departures precipitated a renewed interest in Nokan. The practice has been around for some time, as we noted, but it was mostly seen as antiquated by the time the film was released. After its success, however, Nokan saw a resurgence in popularity. While this could be attributed to the fads that come and go with popular media, we would argue that Departures effectively achieved what was perhaps one of its goals in exploring the beauty of the ceremony. After its success, however, Nokanshi saw a resurgence in popularity. In fact, this may be why the film was successful even internationally. While the ceremony is a specifically Japanese phenomenon, the film helps to show how Nokanshi can bring the living closer to the dead, rather than promoting a hands-off culture of fear. Motoki stated that taking on the role and learning about Nokan helped him face death naturally for the first time in his life.
Not all is well for those who deal with the dead, however. In Shinto, the national religion of Japan, there is a concept known as kegare, which is used to describe things that are unclean. This is not a man-made form of uncleanliness, however, but a natural form. As such, objects and people are able to be purified through the Shinto concept of misogi. And while these forms of uncleanliness may be natural and capable of purification, as is the case with the corpses of the deceased, those who deal in unclean matters are not subject to high social status.
In fact, prior to 1871, there were formalized castes within Japan. This likely won't surprise those familiar with the samurai who reigned at the top of the social hierarchy during the Edo period, a time which came to a close in 1868. You see, as in India with the system that Gandhi fought against, the shogun ruled Japan. One's family lineage determined their lot in life. If you were born into a samurai family, then you were considered nobility. If you were born to peasants or farmers, you would likely carry on the family trade through your generation. And if you worked with the dead or other unclean matters like slaughtering animals for food, you fell amongst the lowest caste, known as the Burakumin.
The name Burakumin means something like hamlet people, and is derived from the fact that, when the caste system was legally in effect, communities of different castes were separated. Not only were these people separated from the rest of society, they faced different sets of laws. Given that the samurai class were considered the aristocracy of Japan at the time, were a samurai and a burakumin to commit the same crime, the samurai would likely be fined, while the burakumin could face jail time or even execution.
When legislation passed in 1871, officially demolishing this system, those alive at the time were not necessarily quick to change their ways. While such legal disparity was no longer a reality, the communities remained separated, and discrimination was noted to have run rampant. In the 1920s, the first Burakumin groups were established to help fight this oppression. Though largely broken up during the years of World War II, a consistent effort has been made since 1945 to stop defamation and discrimination against the Burakumin. Even today, the subject of the invisible caste is somewhat taboo, with few writers and filmmakers tackling the subject head-on. As such, it's not easy to determine what level of discrimination Burakumin face today, though in Departures we see that this type of stigma still exists.
Mika, Daigo's wife, attempts to be supportive early on in the film, chalking her husband's new job up to him needing to pay the bills. However, when she confronts him as to whether or not he intends to make a career of being a nokan, they have a spat. In this manner, we can see that some amount of discrimination does still exist within Japan regarding the unclean professions like those of morticians. Mika isn't concerned so much that her husband will be harmed in his line of work. More so, she's worried how this career will affect how others view her and Daigo.
We see this again when an old friend of Daigo's runs into him. They initially chat and all seems pleasant, and they part ways. However, by the time they cross paths again, word has spread about Daigo's new job as a nokanshi. The old friend tells his wife and daughter to wait off to the side before telling Daigo to get a proper job. He doesn't want to associate with Daigo as long as he remains in the field.
Through these exchanges, we can see that the filmmakers firmly believe these prejudices against Burakumin and any others who take part in unclean work are a reality even today. This is just one of the many parts to the puzzle that is Departures, however.
As we said, it's not difficult to see, with how affecting, yet not overly sentimental, with how funny, yet in a realistic manner, Departures won over audiences worldwide 10 years ago. If you haven't seen this one, we highly recommend it. It can teach us about the plight of the Burakumin. It can act as a record of the practices of Nokan. It will likely pluck your heartstrings with the deftness that Daigo plays his cello. Departures deserves to be remembered, and this is why we both appreciate the request and recommend it to all of our viewers.